morning friends.
Morning, sir.
Today's subject is on CSA function same triangle. But this time we take up the formulation using natural forms. The reason why we are deriving the system of P matrix or the state displacement matrix for the triangle element again, there are two reasons. To understand the process of developing P matrix in natural coordinates, that's one thing. Because we can't do completely this formulation for any element other than triangle element. So coordinate, we cannot complete the process on the coordinates. That's one thing. And another thing, to understand the intricacies when we follow the natural coordinate system is the Cartesian coordinate system. So the final end result, what we get, is same as what we got earlier. So if we develop in the P matrix, getting strain and modal displacements, that's going to be utilized in formulating this difference.
Coordinate varies 0, 1, 0 here all along the
same way we can define the third, fourth one. Another way also that can be interpretive, much before the concept of FE, someone has developed a concept. He developed a coordinate called triangular coordinates. Coordinates by triangular element. Maybe it's some intuitiveness or some interest to him, even without knowing all the applications of it, he developed an interesting concept. See, always when I have a point in a triangle, we give this with xy coordinates. Other than xy coordinates, with the triangle, can we define that point by some other means? So we choose a point here, we have chosen a point here, by joining this point P here. How can we designate this point P? What are the different ways of designating point P within the triangle? For all purpose is to represent a point within a triangle in a different form other than x. How do you designate this point?
Distance
from vertex. A lot can be spent on this. You can yourself can look into this. Say, if you exclude node 1 and introduce point P, we'll be getting a triangle. Let us call this triangle as your. Excluding node 2, we'll be getting another triangle with P in place of 2. Same way, we get a triangle here, let's call it. So you say A1, A2, A3 are the coordinates, A are the areas of three different triangles. We get these three areas for any point within the triangle. As long as the point P lies within the triangular space, is going to have this. Now, shall we say, there are three coordinates, let us say C1, C2, C3 are the three coordinates to define. Let us define A1 by A is the first coordinate, A2 by A is the second coordinate, and A3 by A is the third one. Can you guess what happens C1 plus C2 plus C3? Some of these three coordinates are equal to 1, so only two of them are independent. And A1 by A, can you give me any other meaning? You can say, what is A1 from this side? This is a base and this is a height. A1 is equal to half into area, half into this base into this height. What is total A? This height. So it is a ratio of this to this. If the point is here, A1 by A for this is ratio of this to this. Okay. Those days they refer to them as the triangular coordinates. Now we can choose these coordinates as our natural coordinates because they have a range 0 to 1 and it parameterizes the triangle. Or representing the dimensions of a triangle in parametric form. Now knowing this, this has, let us call this for our convenience as R. Let us refer to this as S. This here. Many people use the symbols zeta, eta, psi. But when you try to code, those symbols you cannot use in our coding. So to make it comfortable there, I am using the symbols RST. We are using symbol alphabets. So from now on, RST means the natural coordinates are included. And in this case, T is not independent. We can say this is equal to 1 minus R minus S. Now we need to look at the variables. We have the element now. X1 by 1. X2 by 2. X3 by 1. The element is defined with its geometry. Now we have the numbers, what numbers 1, What are the order variables? In-plane. In-plane variables are displacements in x and y directions. So, this is our u1, v1, u2, and here we have the coordinates. Everywhere in between we have the natural coordinates or xy coordinates for any given point. Now we wish to represent our interpolation in the natural coordinates. That is our primary concern. So with this natural coordinates we can define the geometry as well as the field variables. So we can look at the interpolation now. Let us say x and y. We need to find x, y for any given point internal to this element. Knowing the natural coordinates at that point or vice versa. So we said this is n1 times x1 plus n2 times x2 plus n3 times x3. Y is n1 times y1 plus n2 times y2 plus n3 times y3. Here we have the interpolation for geometry. If you try to represent a triangular patch in CAD environment with straight sides, obviously we go for this kind of representation and we refer N1 and N3 as the branding functions. Branding functions, or we can call them simply the interpolation functions. These functions interpolate the geometry. What are the features required for these functions? We know at node 1, x is equal to x1. That is possible only when n1 is equal to 0 and n3 and n3 are zeros. Sorry, n1 equal to 1 and n3 and n3 are zeros. Similarly, y is y1 at node 1. So n1 must be 1, n3 and n3 are 2 zeros. Same logic we extend at node 2. X is equal to x2 and y is equal to y2. Where it is possible? Now, whatever the function that satisfies the requirement will suit as interpolation functions. And the beauty here is the triangle natural coordinates, what we identified just now, they fit into, they satisfy the requirements. So, straight away we can choose this as N1 because R is equal to 0. This is to say, this R is equal to 1 here. Let me use the color. On this boundary, you can say R is equal to 0 and R is equal to 1. If this point coincides with this, A1 is equal to A at the maximum height. Similarly, if you take other coordinate here, S is equal to 1 here and S is equal to 0 here. Same way, on this boundary, T equal to 0 and here T. At any given location, R plus S plus T equal to 1. This property sometimes we exploit. We represent this as partitions of unity. You take at any location, sum of these three coordinates is equal to 1. So the interpolation functions are parts of a unity, and this property is popularly known as PU property, partitions of it. Now we have the interpolation for x. Then what about u? We are using three nodes to represent the geometry. Same three nodes we are using to represent the field variable. So we can manage with the same interpolation functions. At node 1, u is equal to u1. And u2 at node 2 and so on. That is the same kind of interpolation we can perform. And we can say n1 u1 plus n2 u2 plus n3 u3 on this is n1 v1 plus n2 u2 plus n3. And our m1 is r, n2 is equal to s, and n3 is equal to 1 minus r. Is that clear? Now, when we use the natural coordinate system, we represent the geometry as well as the field variable in interpretation. We interpret the geometry as well as field variables. Is that clear after this? Now, what are the additional hurdles we are going to come across when we switch over to natural coordinates? We discussed that in our previous class. We will try to gradients of any function. See, if you say phi is a function, it has a gradient in xy space as well as natural coordinate space. How to relate these gradients? Just I'll put it again for convenience. Dou phi by dou r and dou phi by dou s can be written as dou x by dou r, dou y by dou r, and dou phi by dou x, dou phi by dou r. Dou phi by dou r is dou phi by dou x into dou x by dou r plus dou phi by dou y into dou y by dou r. This is what I gave yesterday, again I am giving you. So this is dou x by dou s and dou y by dou s. And we refer to this as the Jacobian matrix. Now, can we get the Jacobian matrix here? I am writing directly. Look at this. Plug these functions in x and y. R into x1 plus s into x2 plus 1 minus r minus s into x3. What is dou x by dou r? X3, x1 minus x3. Dou x by dou r is x1 minus x3. Yes. Insert these functions in the expression and differentiate that with respect to r. Okay? X1 minus x3. So in our notation we can write that as x3. Clear?
X2.
X2
minus x3.
Dou x by dou r. X1 here, 1 minus r minus s here into x3. So x2, x1 minus x3. Is it right? Similarly, dou y by dou r. Dou y by dou r. Y1 minus y3. So we can write this as y1. And dou x by dou s. Dou x by dou s.
X2
minus x3, that is x2 3, and dou by dou s, that's it. As I told earlier, many of the times, if you move in a systematic way, there's nothing graded here. High school level mathematics only. But at a glance, many a times, that gives the impression it's very difficult. Appears to be difficult, but they're not really difficult. To remove the fear only, I am doing all this on the board. There's not at all, nothing to be remembered in the heart manner. Once you have this, can we get inverse of the Jacobian now? Shall we write this as 1 by detriment of the Jacobian? What is inverse?
Sir, x3 should be in place of y13.
these two.
Okay.
So diagonals will
sir, these
diagonals will represent the remain, they have only changed their sign. 5, 2, 3, x1, 3, minus y1, 3, minus x2, 3. Is it right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And can you guess what is the letter of the Jacobian? What is the letter of Jacobian? The determinant of Jacobian is nothing but the twice the area of the triangle. This you can verify. When you expand the determinant and verify, they are going to give you for any given triangle that gives twice the area of the triangle. So from this determinant, you can also get the area of the triangle whenever there is a need. Instead of going for additional calculations. And now, once you have this J inverse, now we are ready to explore. We need to go after this. It's clear? Now let us go to the next step. What is our objective? What is our objective? From here, shall I reproduce dou phi by dou x, dou phi by dou y is equal to 1 by determinant y plus y to 3. Minus y1 3
minus x2 3
minus x2 3
x1 3
x1 2 1
3 1 3 x1 3 x1 3
x1 3
yes
2 5 by 0 r 0 5 by this we finally. So here this is, now look at this. This vector gives the gradient of any given variable in the given triangular element in Cartesian space. Vector of gradients of any function in Cartesian space. Vector of the same variable, gradients of the same variable in natural coordinate space. And what we relate here, this is our inverse of the Jacobian matrix we are going to use. Now we wish to get the straight displacement matrix. In plane elasticity, what are the same components? Epsilon, xx, yy, epsilon xy that is equal to dou u by dou x dou v by dou y. What is the last one?
Dou v.
Just say
dou u by dou y.
Dou u by
dou y.
Dou y plus
dou v by dou y.
Any difficulty? These are our strains based on the fundamental elasticity. Now, what is dou u by dou x? In this expression, replace phi with u. In this expression, replace phi with u. Our dou u by dou x now we can write this as y to 3 times dou u by dou r minus y1 3 times. Okay. Then, what is dou v by dou y? Replace time with v. Take the second. That becomes minus xp2 times dou v by dou r plus x1 some theta as 40 by x. Next, we have two terms. Dou u by dou y minus x to the times dou u by dou r plus x1 three times dou u by dou s, the constant r and s, plus y2 three times dou v by dou r minus y1 three times dou v by dou s. Then we have the next one. What next?
So 1 by E2, 1 by J.
You are right. 1 by J must be there. Common for all. So let us pull it outside. What is dou u by dou r? Dou u by dou r. What is u? N1 u1 plus N2 u2 plus N3 u3. Just not putting on board. Imagine. N1 is r, N2 is s, N3 is 1 minus r minus s. What is our dou u by dou r? R into u1 plus s into u2 plus 1 minus r minus s into u3. Minus u1 minus u3. And three causes here, don't take u1 3, u1 minus u3. Geometry we can deduct. These are the parameters we can do whatever operation we like. But if you can't deduct both variables, u's are variables, you can't combine them using the variables. Plus minus y1 3 times dou u by dou s. Are you able to get this?
U2 minus?
That's it. No difficulty? We know u was expressed as m1, u1 plus n2, u2 and so on. Plug in the expressions for m1, n2, n3. Differentiate with respect to r. This is dou u by dou r and this is dou u by dou s. Next one. Minus x2, 3 and dou v by dou r. V1 minus 3 plus x1 3 times dou v by dou s. Next. Minus x2 3 dou u by dou r. V1 minus u3 plus x1 3. X1
3
U2 minus U3 plus Y2 3
V1
minus V3 minus Y1 3 W by dou S
V2 minus V3
minus in place of M1, N3, N2, you will plug in these RST, differentiate, R and S, full length. Water. are the element nodal displacements. We need to represent the strains as functions of element nodal displacements. Pull them out. In the first row, for expression for W by X, we have only U1, U2, U3. What's the coefficient of U1 here?
1, 2, 3.
Why?
2, 3.
Coefficient of V1?
0.
0. Coefficient of U2?
Minus
Y13. Right, Y31? Minus Y13. Nothing but Y31. Coefficient of V2? 0. U3? For U3 we have minus Y23 plus Y13. That will be Y. Check this with the previous first row. Last class also we can just check it. If it is not same means, we have done a mistake on that day, on today. See? They are not same. Either today or that day, we made a mistake. So far it is correct. Now, next one. The second row, U1 is not there. V1 is minus X23, X32, V20. Sorry, U20, V2, X13, 0. For come to V3. X23 minus X13. X23. Correct? Last one. Coefficient of U1 here minus X23. X32. Coefficient of V1 minus X23. Coefficient of U2 X13. Coefficient of V2 minus Y13, let us write Y31. Coefficient of U3, X23 minus X13, that is X21. Coefficient of V3 minus Y23 plus Y13, Y13 minus Y23, Y1. That's all. Of the matrix, rest of it, integral B transpose dv. dv, thickness into dx dy or dz times dsv. Now, the next issue, very interesting issue here. Ke is equal to integral B transpose dv. Thickness of element dx dy based on what we have done. Now, this integration is of the xy space. Now, when you see this, of course, this is the double integral of v transpose dv thickness of element that j ds. Okay. Now, what are the limits? What are the limits for R and S?
0 to 0.
R is equal to, first internal S, outside R is equal to. What are the limits?
0 to 1.
0 to 1? 0 to 1? Huh?
Yes,
check it. This is another common mistake becoming. Because it took almost a week for me to recover the mistake. As a student, I did the same mistake when I was doing this course. It took 1 week for me to overcome the mistake, to identify the mistake. Once I identify it, I would work. Huh? Minus? Just think about it. One bonus mark is there for you, for those who get the correct limit.
R0 to 1, S1 to 0.
Huh?
R0 to her S1 to 0.
1 to 0.
Yes.
Alka sample. A triangular element, what you say? When you represent a natural coordinate space, it is an equilateral triangle. It is a master triangular element. It is an equilateral triangle. The answer? All the answers are 1. The triangular element, whatever its shape is, when you represent that to a master element, this is going to be an equilateral triangle with the same. See, if you take the nodes 1, 2, 3, and these are close to where the limits. These are the really tricky issues. R is equal to OK, let me say 1 for the convenience I think. R is equal to 0 to 1. What is S is equal to 0 to 1? Where is S? S is equal to 0 to 1 is here. No damping. I give now proofs. Limits for R and S to carry out integration.
So R 0 to 1, S is equal to 0 to 1. R is equal to 0 to 1, S is equal to 0 to 1 by 2.
0 to?
1 by
2. 1 by?
1 by 2.
1 by 2.
Root 3 by 2.
Root 3 by 2.
Root 3 by 2.
Root 3 by 2. See, when you say R is equal to 0 to 1, it's going like this. R is equal to 0 to 1. S is equal to 0 to 1. From where it is going? Huh? R is equal to 0 to 1. From here to here, S is equal to 0 to 1. Just a minute, yes. 1 minute, let me see. S is, what do you mean? Represent S value. This is S value. S. Yes. We are coming in this direction. When you say R is equal to 0 to 1, you are starting integration of here and then going up to here. And S is equal to 0 to 1. You are starting from here and then going up to here. 0 to 1, what is the aim for 0 to 1 for S value? For R value? What area you are taking now? Can integrate between, say for example, take a particular value for R. This is tip for R. If I come up to here, what you have done? Say this is our dr. This tip I say dr. Where is the ds? Ds is parallel to this. This is ds. Dr is varying from here to here, 0 to 1. Ds? S is varying from, normally for what is when you choose 0 to 1, it is varying from here to here. S is varying from here to here, means when I take this here, up to here. What is the value for S now, tell me? From where? What is the limits for S? R, of course, we have limit 0 to 1. For S, what are the limits?
0 to 1.
S is starting from here and going in this direction. I will start from here when I am integrating this. What is the limit here? This is what we are going to limit, get now. What is the range for S from here to here? What is the value of S here? What is the value of S here? What is the value of S here? 0. What is the value of R here? Sorry. S here? Value of S here, from here to here only it is coming. On this point, what is the value of S? On this, what is the T on this line? What the?
T equal to 0. 1 plus R plus S is equal to 1. What is S?
So, otherwise if you go with up to 1, you will be going all this excess area going. When you come to this side, this excess area also is 20.
So you will be getting double the area if you take 0 to 1, 0. To overcome, just I was getting double the stiffness without doing the reason why. The moment I identified the stiffness, what I am getting is double. Then I got it out and then I look at the references. Till that time, even I have not even bothered to look at the reference to check the limits. Then we realize the limits for this, S is equal to 0 to 1 minus R, and this is 0 to 1. Just if you look at this, easily you can see. Only thing, I'll try to look another figure. It looks better. Say this is node 1, node 2. Let me say node 1. We are moving in this direction. Node 2. We are moving in this direction. So dr, if you take value for dr parallel to these two lines, this is surface differential length r. This is parallel to the base. If you say dr, imagine this dr. Where is ds? Parallel to this. When you say dr, ds, this is the reason. That reason is our dr, ds. For this, r has a range from this end to this end. S range is? S range. Coming from here to here. S is varying only. Already this we have completed. When you complete this, S is, has to move from this end to this end. That's clear? So once you complete this, otherwise, this will be giving you double the stiffness. R is equal to 1 here, R is equal to 0 here, we are starting from here. R is equal to 0, we are starting from here, up to this point. From here to here, this part here is designated as dr. And what is the range for S? When you have gone up to this region means, we have completed computing the area here. Now we have to complete the area corresponding to this for dr. What is the range for S on this? What is the value of S on this? S is equal to 1 here. Yes. And S is equal to 0 here. What is the integration you have to perform only from here to here? Yes. Here, what is the value of S?
0.
What is the value of S here?
At this, on this side, T equal to 0, third coordinate is 0. 1 plus R plus S is equal to 1. So 1 plus R plus S is equal to 1 here. So S value on this boundary at this location is 1 minus R.
That's not true. So this is only fun point we have in this. Similar thing we encounter in tetrahedron elements. These intricate difficulties we encounter only when we formulate the stiffness matrix ourselves. If you are using a package, you never come to know what these are. This layer now, this completes the formulation of stiffness matrix. And load vector path I postpone to all the 2D elements to a later time. Load vectors we take them separately along with the quadrilateral elements. We discuss them separately. Now, there are few other issues. The shape of the element, do you think the shape of the element has something to do with the accuracy? Shape of a triangular element, what will be its influence? Shape of the element.
Error. Approximation.
Approximation. It all depends on this development. Just look at this. A triangle can be like this. It takes some coordinates here, that's it. 0, 0, m, comma, 0, 20, comma, 1. You identify the geometric matrix for this? Nodes 1, 2, 3. So the Jacobi matrix. See x13, Jacobi y23, y2 minus y3,
minus 1,
minus y13,
plus 1,
then x23,
plus
20, x23. 2 and 3.
This is
x2 minus x3 minus 10. And x.
So minus 1 minus 10.
Plus
10.
This is plus 10 x. Minus of x2 is plus 10. x13?
Minus
20. What is the determinant of this? Minus 2 minus plus 20 minus 10. Okay. Now see the numbers here. So actually here, as long as you get the range of these values in Jacobian close, if all the values are close together, then that gives you a better representation of it. And the huge variation in these numbers will indicate the distortion. If by chance, without the knowledge, this becomes zero, what happens then? Formation of triangle, you know.
Yes.
But when you give the, when you feed the data, nodal coordinates, you compute the nodal coordinates and algorithm that gives the nodal coordinates and it shows the data to compute the J, it brings the data. One of them is zero. What happens then? So, what happens to this? Look at the elements I'm telling you.
0, 0,
and this is y2 and y3 are same, whereas we have y23 0. y13 is also 0. What is the determinant here?
0.
So, 0 determinant for a Jacobian clearly indicates. Singularity for J matrix indicates the shape of the triangle is not wrong. And another thing what we normally say is the best is 60 degrees for a triangle. See, as long as if you look at only in terms of angles, the master triangular element, when you plot the triangular element in natural coordinates, that is going to be an equilateral triangle. All the sides of length one. Sorry, length none. All the heights are one unit. Right? What are the angles? What are the angles?
60
each. But your actual triangle has different angles, but the master triangle has 60 each. the deviation in these angles to the actual triangular element and the master triangular element indicates the fineness of the element. Ideal is equilateral. Whatever the element that is close to equilateral is acceptable. That's the reason why normally when we check the accuracy, check the meshing, one thing is we try to find the angle. 60 plus minus 25 or plus minus 30, that's what we accept. 30 to 90 is usually acceptable angle. In a triangular element, no angle can go below 30 or can go beyond 30. 90 sometimes, if 90 becomes more, what happens to other triangles? Right? None of them is less than 30. Two 30s, what is the next? Two of them are 30s, what is the third angle?
60, 120.
At the most, that's the thing. Beyond that, normally we refine it. When you are devising an algorithm to mesh the given structure into triangular elements, these are the cautions one has to keep. Anyway, when you are leaving into software, look at every option available in the software meshing is related to the quality of the element we are going to get at the end of mesh. Got a point here? Many a time, though there are several options available, people go with the default options. Try to interpret and understand the options. There's nothing great in it here. The options available in meshing are directly related to the quality of the element. Same logic is extend to quadrilateral element. What are the total angles? 490 is ideal. 90 plus minus 90. Acceptable angle. Okay. Is this clear? Now the next one, we think of higher order triangular elements. What is the need for going to higher order triangular elements? What is the major limitation for this? Why we thought of going for natural coordinates? If the basic triangular element like this, whether you use the natural coordinates or Cartesian coordinates, no difference at all. Once you get the B matrix, it doesn't matter whether it is the natural coordinates or Cartesian coordinates, because area we can compute anyway knowing the nodal coordinates. But the reason why we are looking at is, why you are looking at natural coordinates?
Integration.
To make the integration possible, even if B is having some variables. That means higher order variation for strain and higher order variation for displacement. In such a case, how to diagnose? Now give me some ideas. We wish to represent the stress and the strain quadratic. At least one quadratic term is required in my interpretation for displacement. At least one quadratic. Tell me the possibilities. At least one, or ideal case, all the quadratic terms must be there in the displacement field. Think of a means. See, don't look at the shapes of the elements. The shapes of the elements, what we come across, these are based on our requirements. Our requirement guides a particular shape. Don't always go with the shape and find out your stiffness. If we wish to represent U and V to a higher order quadratic, either in XY space or in natural coordinate space, order is going to be same. Stretch your imagination. At least you take clues from the previous case. Bar element we had, under self weight we had a variation, quadratic. What we did?
Increase the number of
nodes. How many? As per the
required.
If you wish to represent U as a quadratic function, how many coefficients are there in a quadratic function? One is 10, two linear terms, What are they? Six terms are there in the polynomial. So these six polynomial coefficients need to be replaced with six discrete variables. How many nodes are required?
Six.
When six nodes are required, you can devise or you can think of a polygon with six sides, or go with a triangle with nodes at the video level. Got a mind here? Six discrete variables for V. Already we have three. Where shall we take the remaining three?
Yeah.
Huh? So identify the midpoint possibly. Let us say this is 4. Or this is 5. So at every node we can identify U1, V1, U6, V6. For every node, we have a displacement, displacement, y direction, u and v correspond. Now, what is our u? What is our u? For any locations, for any given location, with the natural coordinate space, n1 u1 plus n2 u2. So we should write a long expression. Shall we simplify that? Shall we use this notation, summation notation? Sigma ni ui I is equal to 1 to 6. V is equal to sigma ni vi I is equal to 1 to 6. So this is the interpretation for field variables. You have six interplane functions per field. As we are using the natural coordinate system, there is a need for us to relate geometry with the natural coordinates. To represent the geometry for this element properly, how much information is required for us? To represent the geometry of this triangle, how many nodal coordinates are required? How many nodes are required?
Six.
All six are required?
Three.
If you recall, I stress the point, let us take them at the midpoints. If you know x1 and x2, can't you get x4? So geometry for the intermediate points is not independent. Do we need to represent that? Do we need to identify the geometry? So to represent the geometry, how many nodes are required? Is this point very clear? Make sure. Geometry doesn't require more than 3 nodes. Even for a bar element also, though we had a node in between, though we have not interpreted geometry, their geometry
has variation only linear. Here the nodal coordinates x and y varies linearly within the element, whereas the field variables varies to a quadratic function with them. So variation for geometry and field variables is not the same. Now, if we represent x and y, what will be your x now? Sigma ni xi, I is equal to v, and y is equal to sigma ni yi, I is equal to circumference. This is the interpolation now we observe separate interpolations are required for field variables as well as geometry. The geometry decides how many nodes are required, what kind of interpolation is required, and the field variable decides the nature of variational field variable, the kind of input we have, that decides what kind of variation is required for. But both are guided by different factors. Is that clear? The interpolation for geometry and interpolation for field variable are guided by different factors. So if you have a clarity with the geometry description and the field variable description, then we can choose appropriate interpolation. Now if we can say, if we combine all these ends, let us call this as NF. Let us represent this as a row vector, which is NF1, NF2, and so on, NF6 in this case. To make it more distinction, let us use now NFI. Earlier we have the same N now. Let us represent NF to represent the interpolation for field variables, and similarly here, let us represent this as NGI and this as also. Here, for this vertical case, here we have 6 and represent this NG now. How many elements in NG? Only NG1, NG2. As far as this interpretation is concerned, same interpreting functions we have used earlier can be taken care. Okay? Now, depending on the choice of these functions, we classify all 2D elements into 2-3 broad categories. Purely by choice of these interpolations for geometry and field variable, the elements are classified into 3 broad categories. Now this is here, if I say order of NF, let me take NG, this stands for order of NG, if it is greater than order of NF. We have some variation for the field variable, we have some variation for geometry. This stands for order, polynomial order of geometry variables and polynomial order of field variables. And if this is greater, and next case, order of NG might be equal to order of F, and order of NG would be less than order of. And if you look at the CM, these geometry interpolators describe the geometry, use the shape of the number. The shape of the element we get with these functions. Whereas this gives the variation of the field variables. And
unknowingly, the first element we come across, we had a situation that we have used the same interpolation function for geometry and field dynamics. And this geometry representation in CAD environment, if you recall, you have referred with the name parametric representation. Both your curves and your surfaces and even solids also, we represent them as in the parametric form. So the representation case can be referred as parametric representation. There we have a representation only for the geometry. Here we need to represent the geometry as well as the field dynamics. Both we are representing as in a parametric form. So the parametric representation is employed for geometry as well as the field dynamics. If by chance if we choose the same parametric representation in both the cases. If we choose the same parametric representation in both the cases, NG and NF are same order, obviously same functions, same thing, both are same, what's the name we use? Parametric representation is same, uniform, use the term ISO. So in this case, we represent these elements as ISO parametric representation, or simply these elements are referred as isoparametric. So parametric representation, field variables and geometry are represented by the same functions on the same order. Then here, order for geometry is high, more. It is superior. Geometric representation is superior. So you can say this is super parametric. Representation of geometry is a superior order, super parametric elements. And here, inferior, lower, sub, parametric elements, sub, lower. So we refer to these as sub parametric. These are the three classes. And this classification holds good for all 1D, 2D as well as 3D elements. All the cases 1D, 2D, 3D everywhere, this representation is, or this classification is. Now, can you put the element what we have discussed just now? Before commencing this topic, we have formulated the B matrix for a triangle element. And what category does it come? What about this?
Sub-element.
Just recall the 1D elements we have dealt with. Power element. Power element with two nodes.
Isoparameter.
Power element with three nodes.
Sub-parameter.
So in general, when we use Cartesian space only, normally we don't refer with the sub or super parametric or isoparametric elements. Only when we use the geometry interpolation as well in natural coordinates, that time only we bring in the classification of iso or sub or super. And here I am using another term called shape function. So far I was using the term interpolation functions. Just we are interpolating either geometry or field variable at a given location. Whenever we represent these functions in parametric form, this parametric form was originally used to represent the CAD geometries, and that parametric representation leads to the shape of the geometrical shapes that define the shape. That's the reason why the shape function concept has come to be, because people start using the shape function. Whenever we represent this, we say these functions in parametric form can be referred as shape functions. And certainly, the functions we have developed in Cartesian space cannot be referred as shape functions. The interpolation functions developed in natural coordinate space are referred as shape functions. And for isoparametric elements, usually we call shape functions. But still here, I have my own doubts in the sense, in this case, both are same, so we can call shape functions. But when this is this category or this category, which one you are going to call as the shape functions? Not much clarity is there, but people use it just interchangeably. But the logical way to deal with this is whatever the functions we represent, say these are the one which is going to be the shape of the element. Nothing wrong in calling all of them as shape functions. Here, we use the same shape functions, and then we say these also can be referred as shape functions because they give the shape of the field variable which is the domain. That's our arguments. And now, we have the same shape functions either side or different shape functions. Then shape functions for geometry and shape functions for field. But interpreting functions are the best thing. Field variable interpretation and geometry interpretation. Maybe secondary for us as long as we have. Is that clear? So now, can you suggest some examples in 2D which can be titled the triangular discretization, isoparametric, subparametric, and superparametric? Isoparametric we have discussed, subparametric is still there. The element on the board is subparametric. Can you give an example for superparametric? At least, conceptually, what's the requirement for superparametric elements? Higher order variation for geometry. More number of nodes for, see, higher order means more number of nodes to represent the geometry.
Circle. Circle.
Think of a shape at an element level. And the element possesses straight boundaries, you are not for a simple shape like this. Just imagine the boundaries are like this. How many points are required to represent this geometry? Again, next slide, please. These are the triangular nodes, 1, 2, 3. Can you get a shape using these three nodes? What else we need? These. If you know the coordinates of this, midpoints. Three more nodes, we get the midpoints. See, earlier by knowing two cardinal points, we could represent this as a straight line. Now this is a curve. For curve, what is the minimum number of points required to represent a curve? If you want to represent the curve in a parametric form, four points?
Slope. Three points.
In plane, we need to represent a curve. Minimum, I'm asking.
Three.
So we go for, what is that? Where is the location of that point?
What we know, right?
So to represent this geometry now, when you migrate to this, geometry requires 6. Now this refers to this. And I still believe the field variable variation is not that much, the loading is not that complicated, which gives me uniform state of stress and strain, though the geometry has some variation. If I conclude that way, if I can decide my field variable variation is not to that extent, then we go for this. We will say, what is this element now?
Super parameter.
Right? Somebody is may, sir, geometry itself you are representing the quadratic, and my stress is posed by area. Area changes are there, at least quadratic is a variation I need for this. What do we do? What do we do? So we go for 6 for geometry, field variable also. Now, 3 noted isoparametric, 6 noted isoparametric. Two combinations, one subparametric, one superparametric. How many possibilities are there here? Geometry, 3. Field variable, 3 or 6. Geometry, 6. Field variable,
6.
Four combinations, four possibilities are there. So with the more or less the same understanding, we can divide that into three possible cases. Subparametric, superparametric, and isoparametric. Now the requirement is to choose an appropriate element for your problem. Ultimately, it ends up in choosing an appropriate element for your problem. Now tell me, what knowledge is required for you to make a proper choice of an element? What is the essential knowledge required for us to make an appropriate choice for the elements? See, do you think the package can just directly, the several options available in the package could be of help to us? Even if you refer answers, it might give some 95 or plate 95 or plate 90, plate 40, some kind of representation is there. Probably you must be aware of the name of the elements with some code. But ultimately, how do you choose an appropriate element? Let us limit only to triangles today. You've gotten a triangular elements in access or any package you have an access. Locate the element library or element manual. Identify what are the interplane functions of the geometry and what are the interplane functions of the variable. Try to understand what is the category in which it is going to be. What kind of variation it can support for geometry, what kind of variation it can support for the field variable. Now you can understand that? Once you understand that, now look at your problem. What are the desired qualities of the element for your problem that you have to identify? Then you will be able to make a proper choice. Otherwise, it is only the case that somebody, senior has told to follow this, boss has told to follow this, or my sir has told to follow this, I follow. Many times people end up with this kind of... Do you think that is going to help you? If somebody tells you to follow a certain element, to follow certain options, and if you are following and doing that, what is the knowledge you are gaining in the process? Always I keep asking you people when you are doing some analysis. Not only now, when you go to an organization and we carry out analysis at the end of the day, look for what you have learned in the process. What is your contribution tied to the problem? What's the knowledge gained in that process? That knowledge. Sometimes you may say, sir, I don't have much time to make a decision. Your boss will tell you, follow this. The moment you get a time, you start thinking, why did I follow this? What made my boss to follow this? If you start looking, possibilities are there to understand the reason behind it. Next time you meet and ask somebody. Once you understand this, you may even realize there are better options than the element that was suggested to you. But ultimately, what you need here is proper understanding of the problem. One is geometry that you are learning in your CAD. Other one is
variation for the field variables. If it is a structural domain, your advanced mechanics of solids in the first semester, and the plates and shells, what you are thinking now, these are the domain courses that will help you. Only this course will help you to relate things from those two courses. Is that clear? Now we'll look at establishing the interpolation functions for this kind of element or this kind of element. Here we need to establish interpolation for field variable. Here we need to establish interpolation for geometry. Will they be same or different? Will they be same or different? In one case, knowing the six nodal displacements, I am interpolating for field variable or displacement anywhere within the element. Other case, knowing six nodal coordinates, I wish to find the coordinate somewhere interior, which is bestowed in terms of natural coordinates. Will it be same interpolation or different interpolation? As an elementary case, if you need different one, certainly you need to have a reason. Given six conditions, you need to identify a polynomial, you need to fit a polynomial to six conditions. Those six conditions may be geometry or field variable. In what way ready for? You need to interpolate U with six nodal U's. You need to interpolate X with six nodal X's. So the X or U, in what way are different for you? As long as you look at fitting a function, as long as the number of nodes are same and the kind of variable what you are using is same, we are not looking at continuity for beyond first order. U and V need to be continuous. Are you putting any emphasis on the gradients of U here?
No.
Are we taking gradients as our nodal variables?
No.
Unless you go for gradients as variables, no need to look at different kind of interpolation. So, to represent is NG for 6 nodes or NF for 6 nodes, the functions are going to be same. That in terms of the natural coordinates for it. So let us establish those functions. Now, remember, these are the things, the simplest things in this course I am telling you. So I will be only brief. This is here and there, and there is a chapter in many of the books only on interpolation functions. Unless you know the meaning and the relevance of those functions to us, it is very difficult to go through a separate chapter. Now you are maybe after the basic course, basic lecture on quadrilateral elements, you are ready to explore into the field of interpolations. But that's one simple thing. We establish interpolation functions. Can you represent this element in natural coordinate space? If it represents that in the natural coordinate space, what does it look like? In RS space, is the triangle straight lines or different? When you define this here, we say, for the node 1, all along this boundary, R is equal to 0 and here same way all along this boundary. When you see in XY space, R and S are quadratic. This is R is equal to, sorry, S is equal to 0 and this is S equal to 0. Same way we can say T. This is the boundary where T equal to 0. So this will be T equal to 0. In XY space, the element shape is like this. Bring in RS space, the natural coordinate space is there. Triangle, straight boundaries, and of course the equilateral triangle.
let us say from 1, 2, 3, 4 point. We wish to establish the entropy. And let me tell you, there is no unique way of computing this function. There are several approaches. There are several functions also possible for this. We look into one simple approach that we are going to get just by inspection. By intuitively, we can establish these functions. Interest is going to play over here. Now let us say, this is run coordinate. This is T.
R into R minus half will make it 0
at every location other than node 1. What is its value at node 1 now? We have a function already. What is its value at node 1 when r is equal to 1? When r is equal to 1, it is
1 by 2.
We wish to make it 1. How can we make it 1?
Multiply
it
2.
So, make it 2 into r into r minus 1. Now we can say this is equal to r into 2r minus 1. It's quadratic in r. N1 is a quadratic function of r. Same logic. Who can tell me the function for N2? Any difficulty? Once we understand this logic, yes, there is a similar variation. That is 2 into s into s minus half or s into 2s minus half. L3. That same thing, 2t into t minus half, that is equal to t into 2t minus 1. Replace now t equal to 1 minus r minus s. N3 becomes real function of r. First you express this in terms of t, then replace t with r minus. Though we have the third natural coordinate here, but third can be expressed as a function of first and second. Now, what about N4? Who can tell me this? The node number 4 is here.
N5, not 5.
matrix, which is this, C equal to 0, S is equal to 0, minus 8, S, T into R is equal to 1 by 2. So we can say R minus half, that is equal to 4 ST into 1 minus M6. Minus 8. R is ST. PR. S minus half. That is equal to 4. PR. 1 minus. These are also. Now, when we have an element now, stuck it. I'll give you something for you to practice to get more insights into the nature of triangle elements. I'll give you a set of exercises, and two of you can take that as your minor. One is a regular triangle with three nodes. Other one is six-noded triangle. When you see for different shapes of the triangles, for different angles, even sometimes one angle may become negative also when you try to represent them inappropriately. So choose the coordinates, six coordinates, giving different arbitrary shapes, identifying the mapping. Maybe you can draw the triangle in 2D space. And in natural coordinates, of course, it's an equilateral triangle. And identify the Jacobian at different locations. What is Jacobian? What is Jacobian? Determinant, sir. Jacobian relates the gradients. Determinant of Jacobian, what do you get? What is physically the meaning of determinant of the Jacobian? Area that leave it. Determinant of the Jacobian, that's another thing. Any other? See, here, if you take this, this is our dx u, and if you choose this as your rs, in this case, we will be choosing something dr, maybe something like this, ds may be something like this. If you take a small element dr ds, now you know r, what, you know s. drds and dxdy, these are related. And you say here, r is varying from here to here. This is the diagram for r variation. Say this is the variation for r. The variation for s, note to here, something like this is the variation for s. When you say drds, this is something like this. The gradients. With respect to RS, this angle will give the gradient of X. And with respect to this, this will give the gradient of Y. With respect to X axis, we have the gradient for R and S. With respect to Y axis, we have the gradients for R and S. The elements of this Jacobian are these gradients. When you see the determinant, when you take an elemental area dxdy, and this dxdy, this is spanning in a natural Cartesian space. And drds is spanning in natural coordinates space with normalized 0 to 1. So it is going to be mapped to this. So if the Jacobian is negative, what happens? By chance, determinant of the Jacobian, can it become negative? When it is going to become negative? Can a determinant of the Jacobian become negative? We are relating areas. That means when it can become negative, one of the gradient unduly changes. So now you take different shapes, left to the imagination, first write a code. Imagine this element. This is node 1. This is node 2. and by chance node 3 comes here, See the kind of job that we get. And further, if you map this, depending on the unevenness in the element, job will appear as a huge variation. So what I suggest to you is, for different proportions of a triangle, you make a sketch of a triangle on a graph paper, arbitrary triangles with a distortion as well with normal triangles, right? And draw a sketch on a graph paper, identify the coordinates, work it to your MATLAB, then you draw a triangle in XY plane, go for 3D plotting, on the other side, represent the detrimental geometry. When the detrimental geometry is becoming negative, just to see what are the gradients. See, as I told, the elements of the Jacobian are the gradients only. Right? This, though it is more of a cat, but has a lot of relevant flux. Just when you are going to represent the surfaces in a proper manner, the result is going to cover any misrepresentation of geometry can lead to difficulties. So try to understand the influence of geometry interpolation when the element shape is somewhat distorted. Huge distortion is there in the element shape. What is influence? Just I'm showing you only the geometry distortions. As I thought, try to understand the influence of each and every element of the Jacobian. Try to interpret. If you can plot XY coordinates and RS coordinates for a given element, try to identify gradient dou x by dou r, variation of x with respect to r, the angle between, tangent of the angle between x axis and r axis. X to R, X to S, Y to R, Y to S. So that gives you a real intent of geometry. So two of you can take this problem, present your result, right? So bring out the result, that will be easy for me even to explain how we can interpret the data. I don't expect you all to get the same kind of interpretation at once. You come with the data, then ensure that you have done it properly without mistakes, then we can spend some time in understanding that. Okay. So, with this, we close it today. If you have any doubts on this topic, we can spend a few more minutes of time. Say for example, when I say we have a domain, that domain we divide into 100 elements. 20 of them of one type, 30 other type, another 50 another type. Quite possible.
So then
the choice remains with us.
So the classification with respect to the element, not with respect to the type of analysis we have done.
No, the type of analysis.
That's how two types of elements are there. So that we can't say that it is parametric, super parametric, or sub parametric, entire analysis. Some cases we have the geometry.
Yeah, I understand. So if the geometry is complicated in some regions,
right.
Some regions the geometry is very simple,
right.
Then really there is no need to go for higher order geometry interpolation
everywhere.
For regular geometry. Mm-hmm. Even if we have the same thing, probably they can think of this way. Really there is no need to go for So we can divide this into several regions. Obviously, we can do it. In that case, what happens? We'll be using different type of elements in different regions. Some of them, obviously, geometry can be to a lower degree. Here, geometry to a higher degree. Interpolation also, when the variation in this region, the variation may not be very high. But in these regions where the sharp changes in geometry may lead to higher variation in the field variation. So that's what I was mentioning. Once we anticipate the kind of result we are going to get, we need not know what are the exact values. what's the kind of variation we anticipate that gives us ideas to choose an appropriate. Did I answer your question?
That is fine, sir. Only thing is that when we say that the analysis, when we carry out the analysis, besides takes a dominant, they can mix elements. So it has a mix. We cannot say it is a super parametric just for the sake of classification.
This classification is not for a structure, it is for an element only. So a structure can be discretized into several elements, into three classes, even four classes. Just now we have seen four classes of elements. All the four classes of elements can be part of a single cell. But usually people go with one class of elements. This is what I know my class. But quite possible.
Bending?
Why not? The moment you are going to represent the interpolation in natural coordinates, you need to interpret geometry also. There also show you decay. Decay represents the relation between the actual length and parametric form. The length is 2 units or 1 unit. But actual length is that. How do you get that length? For simple elements, we know that is the length x2 minus x1. If you get a systematic way, that comes from the interpolation of geometry. Imagine a curved beam. Curved path, what is curved? Still it is axial. We have a streamline pipe. Pipe is the form of a streamline. Fluid is flowing. Our field variable is one of the fluid properties. Geometry is varying to higher order. And fluid property, if it is following perfect streamline, it may not vary to higher order. Or the fluid property also changes because of the turbulence or some frictional drag. Then that also need to represent the higher order. But then there are several possibilities. I am telling you again, this choice is based on the requirements of your problem. Unless you have a clarity with the requirements, I don't think you will be able to make a proper solution. Spend more time in understanding your domain. And this FEA has come to a stage where the moment you choose your element choice and the options to discretize, the rest of the thing is going to be automatic. You need not involve much. Still, I believe the choice remains with you. But once AI comes into our domain, even already it might have come in a small way, then this choice also will be taken care by an artificial intelligent program. Probably that could be there already. What is there? Already small way artificial intelligence is built into our packages because several of the options are default.
The newer version of the software, they are not even asking us to make choice.
So it is because the majority of their users, they realize given an option they are misusing, so they want to freeze the options, defaults, the best options. So you need to override those options, but then you need to have a bit of the money.
The way I said, you can use the mixed elements in the domain. In fact, an element itself, when you have one edge curve and other two streaks, because we have said you may have
quite possible. See, I'm telling you, these are the simple things. I haven't come across, but certainly we can have it.
I think
I'll tell you one element where you can have the node numbers based on your choice. You design your element. One of you is going to get a problem where you will be having n number of elements. That n we'll discuss on that day. The choices are many with same set of functions. By suppressing some nodes or by activating some nodes, we can get all those features.
That example you gave, that one. In fact, 180 is straight.
I'll give my simple.
Other two are parallel, sir.
You think of this. So we come back to this problem at a little later stage. In the meantime, you think of this circuit. All the four boundaries are covered. I try to make it straight divisions. How many types of elements are there? Later class, when I can't tell you exactly now, will be establishing interpolation functions for all the elements that are existing on the board. I will make you establish those functions. Now, this is simple. Like anything complex here? Anything uncommon? See, here we have, this is the type 1. If you take xy space, type 1, then type 2, type 3, type 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 distinct elements are. None of the two elements are similar. For this element, with the nodes 1 and 2, there is a variation. For this element, there is no variation, only straight 4 nodes. For this, we need this node extra. For this, we need this node extra. For this, we need extra this node. For this, we need extra this node. For this element, we have 2 extra nodes. For this, we have 2 extra nodes. For this, 2 extra nodes. See, I nodes. Think of it. I mean, spending about 20 minutes or half an hour for this time. That time we'll see how to establish the function. Once you establish the functions, formulation is not very difficult. Because we are going to have a general algorithm that you won't get elsewhere other than this class. For any given element, we can develop the B matrix and then stiffness matrix. We are not going into details of formulating B matrix. We focus more on to the interpolation functions, then a generic algorithm to formulate B and then into stiffness. Is that correct? So, any other doubt? So, we'll close it here today and continue. When can we have the next class?